tonight on now is the time to abandon our fear. And I told my wife I was going to have her demonstrate fear when I called her up here unexpectedly to talk about fear. So she's going to demonstrate our fear.
How to overcome it.
We're going to bring the mic down to her. She's a little hobbled.
I thought he was just kidding, y'all.
No, he's not.
Well, I'm just going to go right into telling you what's on my heart.
Good.
I've been praying a couple of days, and today, as a matter of fact, tonight I'm not supposed to be here. Something had come up, and I didn't think I was coming. And I thought, well, Lord, I guess that wasn't what I needed to do. So he opened the door, so I'm just going to do what I think I should do from my heart.
Good.
So we're talking about the time is now to abandon your fear.
Good.
I don't know what all of you fear, but some of you I know, and I know fears that we went through together. So if I call your name, I hope that you're not embarrassed, because I'm probably going to embarrass myself with what I'm going to say. But I feel like the Lord has put this on my heart. So I'm going to start off with Brother and Sister Hudson right over here. You know, we're not fearful ourselves. I'm just going to start with myself. The things that I've went through, you know, in the hospital with pneumonia, thinking, well, Lord, I'm not going to make it. I'm very sick, and they're telling me that I really don't know. And I'm like, well, the most of all, I feel like I'm ready to meet you. I'm going to get to see my mother, which I'm sorry, but this is going to be terrible.
No, that
I have many years, 20-something years, I've waited, and I'm probably going to wait a lot longer. I don't want to go right now if the Lord's not calling me. But I thought, I'm coming to see you, Lord, and I'm going to see my mother and my father and many that have went before.
Sure.
And I'm ready. I think I'm ready. So that kind of thing, really, I'm not fearful of losing my life in this world and going, because I'm going to a better place.
Amen.
Okay, so that doesn't bother me. I broke my ankle. You know, that was a road of not knowing what's going to happen, but I wasn't fearful. You know, the Lord is with you. You overcome through Him. We know that fear is not of Him.
Right.
And then so many things I can think of that happened to me personally, but I'm not fearful. But where the fear comes in is in things that we cannot control. That's not in ourselves.
Right.
It's our children is what makes me fearful. That the devil wants to do things to them.
Right.
I think of a phone call that I can think back to many things have happened. My brother and sister Hudson getting a phone call that their young man was in an accident and they didn't know if he was going to be alive or dead when they got there.
Right.
And the church was praying and he's here tonight serving the Lord.
Right.
You know, our God is not a fear. He answers. We've been singing Sunday. Brother Hudson talked about it. We sang about it, that sweet name of Jesus. Sometimes all we have to say is Jesus. We have nothing else. We have no time. Even in that time of fear for someone else.
Right.
I think about Brother and Sister Bradley. I think about that day that they got that information that their son was out there being fired upon. You don't know if he's going to live. You don't know if he's going to die. But we serve a God that is our protector. It helps us with that fear. That fear that overcomes.
Right.
I can think of a time that you get a phone call from school. And they say, can you come down here, you and your husband? Your child has decided to take their life. We need to speak to you. We need to find out what to do. You need to talk to the counselors. You go there. But my God is an overcomer. And that fear that is in us, He can help us. And He makes a way. And that does not come to pass because you know a God that overcomes that fear. I think about Angie and Larry. They got a phone call not long ago that their children had been in an accident.
Right.
Your heart drops. You don't know what to do, but you say, Jesus, I need you. He overcomes that fear. Whatever you're going through right here tonight, each one of you, some of you, I know what you're going through. But you know what? That fear is not of God. He overcomes that fear.
Yeah.
I think back to when Adam had this situation back in 2010.
Right.
He was fixing to graduate from high school. A lot of things happened. We did not know what was going on. Fear, they tell you, you know what? We're not for sure what's going to happen. He had just turned 18 years old. He had to sign all of his own papers, but every time me and his father were sitting there, they'd say, well, we're going to tell you the truth. It's not going to be good. If they do the surgery the way we think, they may have to totally open his face and take that out. There's no way to just take it out. There's no way. We've been doing this. It started the 1st of February. It was February the 3rd on a Wednesday when Brother and Sister Hudson came. We had the first surgery.
Right.
And then things just fell apart. But still, we called upon God. That fear that comes to a mother, a father's heart.
Right.
You're thinking, God, I've been serving you. How can this be going on?
Sure.
But Jesus, I need you. I know you're the overcomer of the fear. And you know what? Then they tell you, well, we don't know about that. It's very possible that it's connected to his right eye, that he could be blind. It looks like it's possible it could be connected to the brain. He would never be the same again. He'll be handicapped for the rest of his life. And automatically you're thinking, oh, Jesus. What can you say? Oh, Jesus. You call upon that name. That fear comes to you. Not for me, but for my son. And you know what? As you all know, none of that came to pass. Because I serve a God that knows nothing to take care of that fear. The devil, he will torment you. He will try to bring that fear. But you know what? You have to call on that name. That sweet name we've been singing since Sunday. Jesus. Nothing else. I'm telling you, when you call his name, you feel something from head to toe. If you don't even know him, let somebody that doesn't know him call his name. You know what? They're going to feel him. Go to a doctor's office. I just seen it happen not long ago. I was there. And that lady said, call on Jesus. I said, I already have. You're a little bit late. You know, I've been calling on him. And he will come to your rescue. When you have fear, I don't care what kind of fear. If it's sickness, if it is that your child is attempting to take their own life, is that your child, you get a phone call, I don't know if my husband remembers, we were very young, our children were young, you get a phone call that there's been an accident, you need to come down here. How do you know when you get there what you're going to find? You haven't been told what you're going to see when you get there, but you know what? You're already thinking, Lord, I've been serving you, I know, I'm with you. And I know things happen, we all know that things happen. Brother Hudson made us clear of that on Sunday. We don't understand some things. You know, years ago, I think back to the fact that I don't know about the fear part, but I sit with my mother and she said, it's only going to be a few days. I'm going to be gone. I want you to know this. And she would tell me stuff. But even at that time, I was a very young woman. And I said, you know what, God, I don't want to lose her, but she's going to a better place. If that's what you think is best, I have to go on with you. I'm not fearful. I'm not fearful. I'm giving her up to a better place. Fear. Don't let it get you. Don't let it grip you. Like we sing that song, what's under your feet? Put that fear under there too. Because you know what? There is a God in heaven that he can take care of every fear. Every fear. Fear of you losing your husband. Fear of you losing your child. Fear of sickness. Fear of losing your family, your home. You know what? It doesn't matter. He's there. He can take care of it. I'll let the real preacher give you.
Sorry that I asked her to speak. Boy,
she's fired up.
She's just about stealing what I want from you.
I love it.
The time is now to abandon your fear.
Good.
And the guinea's in the way of the clock. Oh, there's another one. Okay. The time is now to abandon your fear. Let's look at 1 Kings 17. Let's start reading. I'm going to read a story. It's maybe a little bit of, a little long, but we're going to read it anyway. And the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, arise, get thee to Zarephath, which belongeth to Zidon, and dwell there. Behold, I have commanded a widow woman there to sustain thee.
Okay.
So he arose and went to Zarephath, and when he came to the gate of the city, behold, the widow woman was there gathering sticks. And he called to her and said, fetch me, I pray thee, a little water in a vessel that I may drink. And as she was going to fetch it, he called to her and said, bring me, I pray thee, a morsel of bread in thine hand.
Okay.
And she said, as the Lord thy God liveth, I have not a cake, but a handful of meal in a barrel, and the oil and a little oil in a cruse, and behold, I am gathering two sticks, that I may go in and dress it for me and my son, that we may eat it and die. And Elijah said unto her, fear not, go and do as thou hast said, but make me thereof a little cake first, and bring it unto me, and after make thee and thy son, and for thy son. For thus saith the Lord God of Israel, the barrel of meal shall not waste, neither shall the cruse of oil fail, until the day that the Lord sendeth rain upon the earth.
Come on.
And she went and did according to the saying of Elijah, and she and he and her house did eat many days. And the barrel of meal wasted not, neither did the cruse of oil fail, according to the word of the Lord, which he spake by Elijah.
Praise the Lord.
Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Let's ask the Lord to bless
Lord Jesus.
These words, Lord. We ask you to touch, Lord, dear people. God, it's your people, Lord, that you've called and you've drawn to this house, Lord, today. You're going to bring an anointing, God. You're going to touch our ears to hear, our hearts to receive your word, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
We give you praise for it. Thank you, Lord. Fear. It is time. The time is now. It is time. And that time has come. And it's time to abandon our fear. We need to throw it away. We need to leave it at the altar and abandon it.
Come on.
That means don't come back in 3 hours and pick it up and take it home and worry about it some more. But we need to abandon it there. When a child is abandoned, what does it do? What do their parents do? They forsake it. They hit the road and they get out of town and they leave that child abandoned for somebody else to take care of. Well, if we're leaving our fear at this altar and abandon it there, well, then we'll let God take care of it, because our fear is going to stay there and we're going to go on down the road and let God bless us. Now, this story that we heard about the widow in Zarephath, there was a long way coming for her to get to the place that we find her at in this scripture.
Sure.
Now, the country of Israel, or the country of Judah, had been reigned by a wicked and ungodly king and his wife. I don't want to call her a queen, because she was not queen of anything except queen of me. And that was the wicked Jezebel, his wife. And they had caused all types of evil. They had killed all the prophets that they could find. They had set up altars unto an ungodly god of Baal that sacrificed their children to. And they had called all kind of wickedness to reign in the kingdom. And all of a sudden, one day, this man named Elijah came out of nowhere. And he was known as a rough man. He had a rough blanket of a cloak that he wore. And he was a man that lived in the wilderness. He was not no sissy. He was not somebody that came from a palace. He was somebody that came from the wilderness. And he came and he shook his bony finger in that king's face. And this king had already tried to kill all the prophets that he could find. And this prophet shows up and looks the king square in the eye and shakes his finger at him. And he says, "It's not going to rain until I say it's going to rain. According to the word of the Lord, it's not going to rain until I allow it to rain." And before the king could gather up his senses and understand what just took place, Elijah was gone.
Yeah.
And so God told Elijah to go down to the brook Cherith and to stay there, and that God would provide for Elijah. And so the Bible says that for many days he stayed at the brook Cherith and he drank from the stream that was there. And the ravens came and they fed him in the morning. They gave him a morsel of bread and some flesh in the morning. And in the evening they came by and they dropped off a cake of bread and they dropped him off some flesh to eat. And every morning and every evening for many days, Elijah stayed there at the brook and God provided for him. And as he sat there and the days came by in the brook, I'm going to drink of the brook right now. And the brook ran dry and there was nothing for Elijah to drink. There was nothing for him to satisfy his thirst at the brook. And so God told Elijah, said, "Now, Elijah, I see that the brook's dried up, but I have commanded a widow. I want you to go down to Zarephath." And that's a city that's in modern day Lebanon on the coast of the Mediterranean Sea. "And I want you to go down there to Zarephath. And it's been drought for a long time, and I want you to go down there, and I've commanded a widow woman, and she's to sustain you."
Come on.
So Elijah gets up from the brook, and he grabs his coat, and he puts it on his back, and he takes off across the countryside, and he goes on down there to Zarephath, and he walks into the city, and he walks into the city. Now the city gate, you know, we think of coming into the city and we see the streets that come into the city. We don't think nothing of them. But in biblical days, when you came into the city gate, the area right inside the city gate was a place of commerce. And it was a place of meetings. And it was a place of court. And it was a place of judgment. And when he came into the city, there had been such a famine in the land and such a drought that there was no commerce. There was no judgment. Everybody had sealed themselves in their houses, and they're just holding out, trying to be as still as they can so that they don't lose the moisture and the water and the food that they have hoarded up, because that's all they have. There's no planting and there's no crop being grown this year because there's no water to bring that life up out of the ground. And so when he comes into the city's gate, he sees one widow woman. Now, the Lord told him that he commanded that woman to sustain him.
Right.
And so he comes in there and he sits down, and she's over there gathering up sticks. You don't know why she's gathering up sticks. She's just gathering up sticks. Not logs, not trunks of trees. She's just gathering up some sticks. And he calls out to her. He says, "Hey, say, ma'am, can you get me a little water? I'm thirsty. Can you give me a little water and vessel and fetch it for me? Can you go get that for me? And I'm going to sit right here in the city gate, and as the custom was, I'm going to sit here in the city gate. Can you fetch me just a small cup of water? Not a gallon of water, just a small cup. Just something to quench my thirst." And so as she was going, the Bible says that he called out to her again. He says, "Say, ma'am, can you please just bring me a small cake, just a morsel of bread, just to satisfy this little hunger in my stomach. You know, we've all been in drought. We're all hungry. We're all been suffering. But can you just bring me just a small amount of food? I'm not asking for all that you have." Little did he know that he was, but. "I'm not asking for everything. I'm just asking for a small cake of food." And she says, "I have no cake in the house. But all I have left in my house is a handful of meal. Just a handful of meal. And I've got a little bit of oil. That's probably more oil than she had. Just a small few drops of oil, just enough oil that I can take that roughly ground meal and I can pour that oil on it and I can knead it together and I can start me a little bit of fire out of two little sticks." That's all she had. If you can make a dinner out of two sticks, that's not very big dinner.
Not much dinner.
"So I'm going to take these two sticks and I'm going to catch them on fire. I'm going to make me a little cake, and me and my son are going to eat that morsel of food, and then we're going to die. Because I have no other way to get nothing else to sustain life. All I have is a handful of meal."
Just that.
Now, for her to come to the place where she had just a handful of meal was a hard road. Because for her to get that handful of meal, she was a widow woman. She had no income. She did not have a husband that went out and toiled in the fields or toiled in the shop or was a mechanic or was a carpenter or was a painter. No, she didn't have a husband. So she had to toil for herself and for her. She was not an older lady. She was a young lady that was a widow. She had a small child. And she was left to take care of this small child at a young age and to toil and to make a living for her household, for her family, for her son. And so there was provision made in the law and in the custom of the day that, have you ever been out in the fields of corn or rice, or you ever been out where they plowed the fields and you can see, what do the outside rows of those fields look like? One farmer I heard said, he said if he had it to do, if he could, if all he could do, he would never plant an outside row.
Right.
You know why? Because that outside row does never produce very much. And if you ever looked at the end of the rows, for the first four or five plants, as you're going up into the plant, up into the crop, the first four or five plants are stunted and drought bitten and they look ugly and bugs have eaten them. And then as you get further back into the crop, the plants get taller and more mature and they look better and boy, they produce better. But the outside of the rows and the ends of the rows and the corners of the field where you can't get in there and plow very well, the Bible says that those things were to be left alone, that when you reaped your field, when you went in there to reap your harvest, well, if you dropped any grain, if you were cutting up your grain and you were bundling it up to go take it threshing, they didn't have combines and tractors like we have now. They went out there with a sickle and they pulled it in, they tied all their sheaves up and stood them up on their end, and then they would take it over to an area and they would beat the seed out of the stalks of this grain, and the grain would fall and the chaff would blow away in the wind. And so when you reaped your harvest, you weren't to pick up everything that fell out there in the crop. But you left that crop out there because you had widows and you had the fatherless and you had the poor and you had those that traveled through that had nothing to sustain them. That was their living. That was God's provision for the widows and the orphans and those that were poor and had no way, or those that were crippled. And you weren't to reap up all the way out to the edge of your property, but your outside rows and the corners of your fields, you were to leave out there and let them stand up there, because people come through and the widows and the children, they could come and freely take them for themselves what was left over of the residue of the crop. And so for years, she had gone and toiled out in the fields, and she had put back enough meal and enough things to survive, and this drought had gone on for, the Bible says, many days. Probably the drought was 3.5 years, and it was probably about a year and a half or so when it had been drought. So she hadn't been able to reap anything for this whole year. And she was living on the small amount that she was able to gain over the time that she was, when it was available. And so when the prophet came and asked her just for the morsel of meat that she had, that was a great sacrifice. And so she had to make up her mind, am I going to give into my fear? Because I know that that last morsel is all I've got to eat. And over the last months and over the last year that I've been living in this drought, I've had to ration. You know, for the first 6 months or so, it was no big deal, the drought. But after 6 months, 8 months, a year comes by, and there's no crop in the field, well, then that drought becomes very serious. So after there was a time and her supplies began to wane and she got less and less to go, she was resting back her meal, and smaller and smaller portions of her meal were being cooked. And as it got smaller and smaller amounts that was left, there's no doubt she had that crying young one. And when that baby cries, what do you want to do? If that's your child, and that child is hungry, and that child is begging for food, you're going to try with all of your might to make sure that that boy has something to eat, or that daughter has something to eat. And so she would make that meal, and her portion got smaller, and that baby's portion got larger. And over the months and over the time that came, those portions, even the baby's portion got smaller, and her portion got smaller than that. And it was just eating just small portions and small amounts is all that she was doing. And her clothes were just hanging on her like a tow sack. The terrible thing that she found herself in. Terrible plight. It was hard labor just to get him something to live, and it was going away. And the man of God came and said, look, fear not. If you'll just take that small portion of that amount that you have left and make me a cake first and bring it to me.
My goodness.
The word of the Lord says that your fear is going to be unfounded, because that meal barrel will never wax empty, and that cruise of oil will always have oil in it. And you can pour out bigger portions, and you can make more than you've been able to make in months, because there's always going to be more meal in the bottom of that barrel. There's always going to be a handful that's there. So today is the day for us to abandon our fear. The man of God's arrival, sometimes we look at the man of God and we, you know, I've read this story, I don't know how many times, but I've never looked at it the way, you know, you've got a man that's lived in the woods and in the country and in the desert, and he comes up and he doesn't roughly ask her for her sustenance, but he kindly says, Can I pray thee, go and fetch me a glass of water. And I pray thee, just bring me a little morsel of bread. He asked her kindly, even though he was asking her for all that she had. But the man of God's arrival that we take and we look at it so cruelly was really what sustained and saved her life.
Right.
It is the only thing that saved her and her son's life.
Right.
Was her willingness to abandon the fear that she had of hoarding what she had, and that's all that I've got. But I'm going to pour out what God's given to me, and that's all I've got. I'm going to pour it out to the minister and the man of God, and the man of God is going to feed me. God is going to feed me so that I can feed the man of God. Now is the time to abandon our fears. Many times in the Bible, how many times in the Bible? I don't know. I didn't do a count. But the Bible says many times over, says, fear not. Be not afraid. Called Gideon, he called him a mighty man of valor. Now Gideon was one that was hard pressed, the same thing, because the Midianites had come into the land, and Gideon had taken what grain that he could salvage out of his fields, and he was behind the wine press trying to beat out enough grain to sustain him and his family. And God called him, he's fearful and he's afraid and he's hiding, but God called him, thou mighty man of valor.
My Lord.
Fear, the Bible says, fear hath torments. Fear, if we allow fear to grip us, it will destroy our faith. It will destroy our life. The Bible says that there's coming a day, and yea, even now is, that Bible says that men's hearts will fail them for fear.
Right.
When 25 years ago did you hear about somebody having a panic attack?
Right.
And going to the hospital and thinking they're having a heart attack, but it's just a panic attack. It's just fear gone rampant, fear on steroids. All beefed up. He's got power over you. He's got fear. Fear is dread, alarm, terror, panic, fright, anxiety, worry. You can wake up in the middle of the night with a panic attack, sweat all over you, cold sweat, because you're fearful and afraid of what might happen. Not what is going to happen, but what might happen. What could happen. The trouble that's at hand. Fear of heights and fear of depths and fear of falling. And men's hearts failing them for fear. The Bible says, or the word abandon means to give up, to forsake, to desert, to quit, to relinquish, to reject. We need to reject that fear. Romans 8 and 38 and 39, that would come up. Now Paul was writing to the Romans and he said, for I am persuaded that neither death, and how many people fear death? Death of our death, or my family's death, or my son, or my daughter's, or my mother's, or my brother's, or my sister's, somebody in my family, or somebody that I love, or some friend of mine, fear of death, nor life. People are afraid of life and they take their own lives every day because they're afraid of life, or angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, things that I'm looking at, nor things to come, dread of what tomorrow may hold. Nor height. How many of y'all are afraid of heights? I had to overcome the fear of heights. I worked on a ladder at the sign company, and it was 80 feet long. Climb up that extension ladder, 80 feet. Climb out on a little 2-inch square tube. Climb into a bucket, do my work. Climb back up out of that over the rail. Back on that little 2-inch square piece of tube. Climb down that extension ladder. Go in there and move it 6 or 8 inches to get to another spot on the sign. My wife's over there saying,
yeah.
And I'm up there working. I'd been working up there on 60 feet in the air at the First National Bank. And I'm up there working hard and sweating. And you know, I know I'm not on the ground. You just got to remember, you're not on the ground. And don't jump out of the basket. Don't get off the ladder. Buddy, you're not on the ground. And I'm up there working, and I'd hear come people that I knew would come by, and they'd honk, 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 like I'm going to stop what I'm doing and wave at them.
Yeah.
I'm 60 feet in the air, and I don't have time for this. I got to keep going. But fear of heights. Back up here. Nor height, nor depth. How many people are afraid of the water? I live with fear of the water over here. I built a boat, she won't let me take it out. And then she throws out there, she says, and your daughter, she don't want you to take it out. She knows that's true. Nor death, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God. Nothing that we have to fear is going to separate us from God. From the love that God has for us, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. So we need to abandon that fear. Why do we need to get rid of fear? Because you won't go to heaven with it. Don't do it. Revelation 21 and 8. Put it up there. It says, but the fearful and the unbelieving and the abominable. Boy, it just puts right in there with it, don't it? The fearful and unbelieving put it right in there with the abominable and murderers and whoremongers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake of fire that burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. So why did he put the fearful and the unbelieving right in there amongst the most gross people that we know?
Right.
The drug addicts. And the prostitutes and the people that we despise, why did he put them right in there amongst them? The murderers. Because he had the children of Israel and he brought them out of bondage and he brought them to the Red Sea and he brought them to the Jordan River and he told them, go in and have what I want, what you want, what I've given for you, what I've supplied to you. And they refused to go because they were fearful and afraid.
Mm.
And what did they do? They went out in the desert for 40 years and all of them died. Because they were afraid. And the children that they were afraid that were going to be attacked by the giants that lived in the land, they're the ones that went into the land 40 years later.
Right.
Fearful and unbelieving. God wants us to have faith. Faith and prayer. Okay? Everybody say prayer.
Prayer.
Prayer is talking to God and let Him know what's inside of us and telling Him our hearts and our fears and letting Him and pray to Him, and He's going to comfort and He's going to strengthen us and He's going to hear and He's going to answer our cry. But worry is not prayer to God. Worry is praying to the gods of this world and to the things of this world and fear of what can happen in this world. And so if we're worried and we're afraid and we're waking up in the middle of the night with panic in our heart, it's not the will of God. The man of God has said, fear not. The man of God 3 weeks ago said, speak to the mountain.
Right.
Whatever it is that's coming against you and that you're fearful and afraid of, speak to it.
Right.
Tell it the word of God said, and the man of God said that I can speak to this mountain and I can watch that mountain disappear before my very eyes and the trouble of my heart. I can watch it disappear and dissipate and be comforted and be strengthened.
Yes.
Let's abandon our fear.
Amen.
Pastor.
I am encouraged tonight. Are you encouraged when you stand with us all over the building? Word of God tells us God had not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. If we didn't get fear from God, then where did it come from? Well, if we didn't get it from the Lord, we don't need it anyway. Somebody say amen. Ooh, boy, that was a poignant scripture in Revelation. The fearful. Wow. The unbelieving. Aligned with murderers, idolaters. Heavens, think about that. And we suffer fear of a lot of things. We're fearful of all kinds of things. Some people be fearful to come up here and even speak. But you know what? Sometimes your life and my life, we're the only Bible that some people read anyway. See, you know what? We can do it. We can make a greater impact just by living the life than sometimes ever getting up in front of folks and having to speak. But Brother Morrow, thank you. Sister Morrow, you got wound up tonight. We appreciate you. You don't ever have to apologize for being a witness. You know, I've always said this, if we prayed about things as much as we worried about them, first of all, we would have such an incredible relationship with God, Brother Billy, because we prayed that much. Amen. Does anybody here battle with worry? I've got my hand just, I'm going to stick it way up high. Anybody here, you battle with worry? Could it be that that is our adversary's greatest stronghold? Because it's so easy for him to use. It's camouflaged carefully. I can't think that anyone would leave this service tonight and go out and do some illicit drug. I can't think that anyone would leave this service tonight and go out to a bar and drink themselves into oblivion. I can't think that anyone would leave this service tonight and go take on a heroin addiction or take on an addiction to some other illegal drug. But I do know this, that even though we've had this uplifting service inspiring us to abstain from fear, there will be those that when you lay down on your pillow tonight, the last thing you'll think about is not something that you're prayerful about or something you're happy about or something that you found joy and peace about, but the last thing that you'll think about before you go to sleep is something that you're worried about. Worry is fear that's camouflaged to seem like it's okay for us to carry that around with us. But what an incredible burden to bear, the burden of worry and fear. I would ask you tonight, Brother Morrow spent a good time asking us here already. I'm not asking you for something easy, I know that. I know it's not easy, but by faith, okay, let's all just take a baby step tonight. Y'all just take, you know, we used to, I don't know, what was that game we used to play when we were kids? Was it Mother May I Take a Baby Step? Was that what it was, Virginia? Mother May I Take a Baby Step? Mother May I Take a Giant Step? Does anybody remember that? And we'd play that game and a little baby step was just one little increment. Then giant steps. Remember? Life would be so great if everything about it was just giant steps. That we just take giant steps over this and giant steps over that. We just giant steps right through that situation. But in reality, life is full of baby steps. It doesn't look like you're doing very much at all. It doesn't look like you're making hardly any headway at all. But Brother Billy, just enough baby steps. If you don't stop, just don't stop. I know I'm mad, some of y'all looking at me like, what is he doing? That's so crazy. You know what? I'm making progress. I'm not moving but about 3 or 4 inches at a time. But I'm still moving. I'm still moving. I'm still
still making forward progress. Just a little at a time. And I'm not getting all stressed out. It ain't hurting me a lot. Anything I gotta push myself so much to do, because I'm only moving about this far at a time. But I tell you what, I'm still moving. Somebody here tonight needs to remind the enemy, hey, I might not be taking giant steps right now. I might not be leaping over buildings with a single bound.
Hey.
But you know what? I'm gonna keep making baby steps. I'm gonna keep watching. I'm gonna keep moving forward. Even if it's just a little bit, I'm not gonna stop. Somebody here in abandoning your fear, you know, just don't stop. You know what? You might not stop worrying tonight. You might not stop abandoning your fear all in one day. But you know what? Over the next couple of weeks, why don't you just lay it down and say, okay, I'm gonna start doing what the preacher said. I'm gonna start trusting. I'm gonna start trusting. Because Lord, if you didn't give me this spirit of fear, who gave it to me? Who gave it to me? And you know what's in Virginia? I don't want nothing the enemy has. I don't want nothing he has to affect me. So if God hadn't given us a spirit of fear, where'd it come from? It comes from the enemy. All right, I don't want none of that. So I'm just going to keep making small steps in the right direction. And instead of going to sleep tonight worried about something, I'm going to go to sleep tonight thankful for something. That would be a great change for some folks. Not worried about something before I go to bed, thankful for something. Instead of waking up, Brother Bradley, fearful or worried about the day, wake up and be thankful for something that day. Be thankful that you could even get up. Yeah, I was injured. I told you I got injured at the restaurant a couple of weeks ago, a week or so ago. I am telling you, I was terribly injured, couldn't do anything. And I'm telling you, in the last 2 days, I've just been miraculously healed. I'm so excited. I couldn't get up or down. I had to call Sister Hudson, come over, Brother Billy, and help me up. You all see that? That's quite a deal. But man, I mean, I'm not. I don't have any pain. I have no pain at all. Brother Carney, I text Brother Carney and said, pray. Your pastor's tore up, man. I need prayer. I'm in all kind of pain, but I'm going to be there. I'm going to make it. You know what? The devil had even come to me and said, you know what? You have permanently injured yourself. You're not going to get any better than this right here. This is what you got to look forward to. You probably need back surgery right now. And you didn't even go to the doctor. Now you got all these problems because you brought this on yourself. I had the enemy tell me that this week. And you know what? I prayed this, Brother Ed. I said, that might be so. But if I have to crawl on my hands and knees to church, I will crawl, Lord, because I love you. And if I have to have somebody stand me up behind the pulpit to preach your word, I've got some good men in our church and they won't mind. And they'll help me stand up behind that pulpit. And Brother Billy, even if I can't stand, they'll stand there and hold on to me long enough for me to say what I need to say. So that's all right, devil. I'm not worried about it. I'm not going to need no surgery. I'm not going to need it because I'm going to get better. And things are going to get better. And 2 days later, I'm healed. I told my wife this morning, I said, I have no idea what happened to me. I have no idea how this happened. She seen me just get up like an old man all around the house. But today, I've been like a kid. I'm not going to fear it. I'm not going to let fear dictate and mandate the areas of my life. I refuse to do it. I'm going to speak to that fear and say, be thou cast away from me. We've got to do it. Let's pray. Lord, I love you. I stand here with a congregation that battles fear every day. God, those that battle worry and doubt every day. These are things the enemy has in his arsenal to come against us. But I come against that by the name and the authority of the name that's above all names, in the name of Jesus. The Bible said that perfect love casteth out all fear. And Lord, the love that you shed on Calvary's cross for us by giving your life a ransom for us should expel every doubt, every fear, and every worry. Rather than be worried about something, I choose to be thankful. So Lord, every time this week I think about worrying about something,
I'm just going to replace that worry and that doubt with being thankful for something. And Lord, I'm going to be thankful for my blessing. I'm going to be thankful for the truth. I'm going to be thankful I'm even able to do what I'm able to do now. I trust you and I believe you and I obey your word. Thank you for the servant of the Lord who come to minister to us tonight to help us to abandon our fear. Lord, because fear is unprofitable and fear will not bring us close to you but isolate us from you. Lord, when I think about worry and doubt this week, I'm going to speak in faith and not in fear. Lord, I abandon this fear. Can somebody say amen? I abandon my fear tonight. Somebody say amen. Would somebody just simply say, instead of worry, I'm going to give God glory. Instead of worry, I'm going to give God praise. Instead of worry, I'm going to be thankful. In Jesus' name. As they sing this song, would you just lift your hand to heaven? At the end of the day, it's really the Lord that gets us through the stuff we can't get through. At the end of the day, it's the fact that we're connected to Him. The fact that He loves us. The fact that we draw near to God. And He draws nigh to His people. I can't make it without you. Is there anybody here lifting your hand tonight that you know beyond a shadow of a doubt that you need the Lord and you can't make it without Him? Sing it just one more time.
No sweeter name.